My name is Tim, and this is my story. I grew up here in McAllister. We moved here when I was about 9 years old. I went to school, started at some local elementary here, but third through sixth grade was at Indianola. That's whenever we got into church with King's House, and then I spent junior high through 10th grade at Crowder. Home life, I had a single mom of four of us kids. We were all ornery, and our father figures weren't really around much. And so I ended up being the only one at home during my junior high years because we all kind of dipped out one at a time. Rebellious teens, and I played a little bit of sports. I wasn't real active in sports. I love sports, but honestly, we didn't really have the income to, you know, my mom worked all the time being a single mother, so I didn't have an option of traveling or, you know, going to away games and stuff like that. But being involved in church and youth groups and stuff like that, I kind of grew a love for music. John Jr. gave me my first guitar, and that's when I started to dig into music. And so I did the same thing with school. In seventh and eighth grade, it was all about music for me. And of course, being a young teen, listening to a CD player and in his bedroom, jamming out to The Fray and, you know, a bunch of other stuff. But my first, you guys can leave this out, but I remember the first time I smoked weed was what took me out of school. So I'm a social butterfly, and we had a fall festival at Crowder, and it was 10th grade, and my mom allowed me to go down there with some friends, and I had good grades and all that. I was a class clown and stirred up trouble, but no different from any other teen. But I called my sister. A buddy of mine somehow managed to get his hands on a little weed pipe or whatever. He was like, "You want to try this?" And so I tried it, and I called to brag about it to my sister, my older sister, like, "Yeah, I smoked weed the first time." I thought I was cool, like, growing into being an adult. When my mom got news of this, she was not happy and pulled me out of public schools. Struggling with, I was working for temp services, struggling to find good work. I had been in some trouble with the law right at 18 years old, and just I wasn't going down the right path at all. And it seemed like the more that I just tried to figure things out on my own, the less things were working out for me on my own. So at this time, though, I just, you know, kept everything to myself, bottled things up, kept rolling with emotions, up until inside I had just had enough. Nobody on the outside really understood or knew. I didn't have communication with my mom ever since the moment that I had left, and I didn't really have communication with a lot of my family. I pushed them away to continue just doing my thing. And so, but along with that comes the people that closest to you that you do talk to. You just have acquaintances around you that genuinely don't care about what may be going on in your heart. But I didn't realize that I was doing that to myself. And so, at this point, I had mentally had enough, and there was just a lot of frustration going on with custody, back and forth, a lot of failure in my life, a lot of failure as being a father, a spouse, I didn't know what I was doing. And so without note, without, you know, really letting anybody know, I just thought, man, I just had these constant feelings that you're not good enough, you're not doing good enough. I mean, like I said, I just felt like a failure, but I didn't show that. If you were to see me out in public, I was confident, happy, everything was going good, because that's how I was, how I was raised. That's, you know, the outside world raises you to be a man and everything's fine and you don't let anybody know your problems. And at that point, I had, you know, I'd went over to a buddy's house for a little bit, and I hung out there for a while, and I guess coming from them, I was just a zombie. They had told me later on, they had, he had his niece playing in a chair, you know, spinning the kid around in a chair, and he shot a video of it where he showed me later on. They were all just laughing, you know, she'd get up and she was dizzy. And in the video, I was just in the back corner just staring at the wall. And this was 30 minutes before, I guess, I just got in my car, went back to my apartment, and walked up to my apartment. And I had a pistol that I kept. There's a shelf, you know, behind the headboard, behind the pillows, and it was in its case. And I had just pulled the pistol out and shot myself. At that point, the blast from the gun had blew my head back. And at that point, I kind of blacked out and I dropped my head down and I was like, oh crap. Like, I was still conscious. I immediately went into shock, like, I got to get out of here. I remember, in as least graphically as possible, after the blast, I had looked down and just blood was pouring. And I dropped the gun actually in my laundry basket. And I guess my body naturally was like, I got to get out of here. So I had made my way through the apartment, and I was just spitting up blood and teeth through the apartment. I had drug my hands on the wall. There was bloody handprints. And by the time I had made it to the doorway, I was fumbling to get the door open. And I had walked out, and I had lost so much blood that I tripped on the door sill of the doorway and fell out onto the balcony. And at that point, somebody across the road had seen me on the balcony and called the cops and said that some drunk man was falling around outside. And the cops showed up, and I was trying to pull myself up on the railing of the balcony, and I was just weak. And at that point, I think my body was starting to go into shock from the blood loss. And at one point, I guess got frustrated that I couldn't pull myself up on the handrail, and I had slammed my head back on the concrete so hard that later on I had a bald spot for several months. I was coherent up until the time that they had put me in the ambulance, and I was actually friends with one of the firefighters, EMS, that had shown up, and he said, you're going to be all right, man. And I couldn't really talk, so I was, at that point, it was shortly after that that I had went out. I wasn't really coherent during a lot of the hallucinations, I mean, of what was really going on around me. I was pretty high at the same time of tripping out, not trusting anybody. But I know that my oldest boy, Aiden, had drawn some pictures for me. He didn't understand why I was in the hospital, but he had colored some pictures for me, and they had put it on the wall. So when I came to, that right there was like the first thing that hit my mind. It's like, I messed up. During the recovery process, I couldn't talk. I had a trach. Like I said, I was writing notes or texting if I was communicating at all. And there was just some really miraculous healing going on as far as the pace that everything was coming together. So from the damage of that, I still have missing teeth on the left side of my face. I still have a bullet hole in the roof of my mouth going straight up into my sinus cavity. So not often do I get sinus infections because it's pretty easy to clean out. Fast forward, having another kid, making mistakes. I was just starting to see some of those failures that I struggled with in the past kind of rolling full circle. And I didn't want to go through that again. And also, I was currently in a new relationship, having, you know, issues in that relationship. We had another kid. So at this time, I've got a stepdaughter and three boys, and still just doing the same things that I've always been doing. Just work, trying to be this, you know, what my opinion of a good father is, and but still struggling every day. And so at this time, I'm in a relationship with Crystal, and we're both struggling on, you know, how to be better parents, how to be better spouses. And we are backstepping on a downhill slide. Any kind of mistake you can think of that we're making, we're doing it. And we both just told each other it was time to commit and get back into church. So I believe that I'm a walking miracle, and I'm here today to encourage others that may be going through the same issues in their life, the same struggles, that you're not alone and God's looking out for you, and He has a bigger plan for you and your family. And any time that you get in that dark place and all these negative thoughts are just weighing down on you, look ahead at the future. Look at what it could be. Don't sit there and sit in that negativity and just be so flustered and frustrated with everything that's going on, because there's so many people around you every day that are going through the same things. They're going through the same trials and tribulations and struggles. And if you just reach out and pray about it and talk to others and communicate and get with your friends, I think that you'll see that there's so many people that are there for you, that love you, that care about you. And your love's broken things just the way they are. Piece by piece, He's created.
story to tell.